Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to this meeting of Council. This meeting will be live streamed and recorded, and the voices and images of those participating in the meeting and in the gallery may be captured as part of this recording. We acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet and pay our respects to elders past and present. As councillors, we have all taken an oath to carry out our duties in the best interests of the people of Indigo Shire and to do this in a fair and impartial manner. We are all committed to exercising the council's powers and functions to the best of our skills and judgment. Do we have any apologies or leave of absence? I have an apology from Councillor O'Connor. Do we have any declaration of conflict of interest? No. I'd just like to mention that the former member for Indi, Cathy McGowan, sent an Australian flag, which is before you, to the Indigo Shire Council with a certificate that certifies that this flag was flown in the House of Representatives chamber in Canberra on the 21st of November 2016. I'd like to thank the former member for Indi and present that flag to the CEO so that it could be flying above this chamber. Yes. Item number three, which is open forum. We've got two lots of questions. The first lot is from Jonathan Riley.
Evening all. Might just start with you, Mayor. Just a side issue with a rubbish bin that we got for a local cemetery. Don't know if you remember that conversation we had.
Vaguely, I do.
But anyway, that came to fruition. I'd just like to say thank you.
Did it? Thanks. Yeah. I almost didn't recognise you with those whiskers, Jonathan.
Okay.
Did they suit you?
I find that hard to believe, but anyway, it has been a long time, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's been a while. I'm pleased about the bin.
Yeah, no, thanks, mate. I just want to explain items one and three on my questions that I thought better of those. I thought you might take those ones on notice for me, please.
Sure.
And the question that I have got that you've probably all read goes back to probably the last time that I was standing here asking questions. I have noticed in agendas, skipping through agendas of late, that there is mention of Barna Watha having an issue with heavy vehicles, and I just wonder whether as a council you've actually come to any opinion on what's happening with the transport in Barna Watha.
Would that be part of the strategic plan? All right, the Director of Infrastructure.
Thanks, Jonathan.
I just thought I'd get that out of the way before I ask this specific question, Ian. How are you going, mate?
Yeah, good, thank you. Well, look, I guess I was going to respond to the written question there, but you asked a prior one.
Yeah, I just see it written in the agendas of the past that I've looked at, that as a council you've acknowledged that we have a problem with transport in the town, and I just was wondering before I ask that question whether or not you have a policy or a thought on the matter.
No, look, in answer to that question, there hasn't been any more real debate. You might have seen it noted, but there's certainly been no debate in the council agenda or in the council meetings about that, so we haven't formed a view, no.
All right. Okay, well, I dare say without me having to read that question, Ian, if you've got a thought on that question, can you just go for it? I might argue the point a bit, but I would like to reiterate that with the values of a vision of the vision, values and purpose. A few dot points here that as a council, supporting our people and our communities, taking care of our places, townships and infrastructure, and being open, transparent, responsive. You know, and I have a lot of trouble with that, with the issue that we're having in Barnawatha with the transport. But so just with that, I just wanted to say that. I mean, so if you can answer my question, that'd be great. Do you want me to ask it, or are you right, just answer it?
No, that's fine. I can answer it. Look, effectively, your question maybe for the people listening is, will council revoke the permit that it allowed for that allows B-doubles to access Havelock Street? That's your question. And the answer is, look, at the moment, there's no plans to revoke that.
But why not?
Why? I think logically it makes sense to connect the freeway with the rest of the B-double network, which is the Barney-Chilton Road and the roads off to Howlong. So to not provide that connection wouldn't make a lot of sense. That's effectively...
But it's not on the B-double approved road registers, and it was, the permit was given. This is the one that I had to go through the Freedom of Information for to get an answer to. So it was given specific to one operator, not to everybody. That transport depot that's out on Chilton Road is in different hands now, and it's just only being used as a service mechanical repair. So we're having all those transports run backwards and forwards from one side of the town to the other, and it's just it's damaging infrastructure, and these are the reasons that you can revoke a permit when infrastructure's getting damaged. And I find it hard to believe that when you've got a township like Barnawatha...
James? I'm sorry, Jonathan. Yeah,
impacted on.
We don't want a debate, but you can ask another question. I'm more than happy for you to.
You know, this is something that is a permit that was issued to someone that used it without it being a B-double route. The demographics of things have changed, and under the rules of issuing a permit like that, they can be revoked when there's infrastructure damage, and it's happening all the time. And I just don't know why, as a council, that you're so stuck on saying there's no nodes. Why would you want to say that it's access to route? You know, it's we've got trucks coming through town using engine brakes. It's not even a hilly place. I just wonder why you're so firm.
Just ask the question. And do you want to take that question on notice? I certainly haven't seen the road being destroyed.
Well, it's the infrastructure. I'm not just talking about the road. It's the roundabout. It's the sign on the pole.
I'm not going to argue with. Just ask the question, Jonathan.
And Ian knows about the damage. And it's like that water line that got removed. That was why it got removed from the roundabout. We used to have a...
Jonathan, you either ask a question...
Jeez, I would have thought you'd give me a bit of rope.
Well, I think I have. I think I have, but I'd like you to ask a question.
I just think it's... To join the freeway, I mean, it's not going anywhere. Where's it going to go? That's what my argument is.
I think,
and
Mr.
why
Mayor...
did I have to get a Freedom of Information...
I'll just say this, Jonathan, your question has not been recorded.
I didn't come here to have it recorded. Yeah, it was just... when I say to you that I
I asked you to answer, ask a question. This is question answer. It's not debate or arguing or harassing or whatever. Yes, you are. You're going over the same old ground. You didn't like the answer. That's not up to me. Thank you, Jonathan. Vanessa Walsh.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Now, I haven't done this before, so do I read what I sent to you, or do you read it and ask me questions? How does it work? Okay, that's fine. I live in the High Street, and we have a 50 kilometre per hour speed limit alongside the school and through the town. And as you can see, what I've written here, that we've noticed an increase in traffic over the last year since we've lived there, and all through the day and in the night. And I'm just concerned about safety for school children and pedestrians, and the fact that it's 50. Not during school time, but there are a lot of children using the school after school and during school holidays. At the moment, there's no crossing patrol, there's no flashing lights. As you're probably aware in Yack, there's tall trees that give shadows and dappled sunshine, so it just feels like an accident waiting to happen. And I do know that in other parts of Australia, there's 40Ks throughout the whole of the time past a school. So my question is, could the council perhaps consider looking at the speed limit past the school, and obviously, and the fact that there's a lot of trucks coming through, I don't quite know why that's happening at the moment, whether there's a change in the construction around the town, or whether they're being asked to come down through Yack. There just seems to be a difference with the traffic coming through.
The Director of Infrastructure.
Yeah, thanks, Vanessa. Look, probably the best I can do with that one is to confirm that High Street through Yackandandah is an arterial road, so it's managed by Regional Roads Victoria.
Okay.
But look, we certainly work with them on speed limits and road safety issues, so we can certainly take the concerns you've outlined here and put them through. We have a road safety or traffic liaison committee that meets, might be every 3 to 4 months, but that involves police and Regional Roads Victoria and our offices, and we raise speed limit issues and road safety issues, so that can be done. The speed limits, there is fairly rigid guidelines, I think, around the school speed zones, and that will probably provide the answer as to why there's time-based and fixed 24/7 limits in other places. But
yeah, it'd just be good to know that.
But look, we can certainly raise those concerns through that committee on your behalf.
So can I just ask, the Vic Roads, because I had a look at the Twist Creek plan, and they had an overlay of the types of roads, and I wasn't quite across of what they meant, but Vic Road seems to stop at Cars Lane, and then it's called a link road through the town. So I just wasn't sure who was responsible for which roads through Yackandandah.
Look, it is a bit hard. I guess my response to that, there's probably different ways of describing roads and hierarchies, but Vic Roads look after the arterial. Okay. So I guess the arrangements would see in a rural area, so as you come into Yakandanda, Vic Roads have full responsibility. Once we enter an urban area, and there'll be definitions, it's typically the 60K zone, or there can be some other factors, and that becomes then a shared responsibility. So generally, Vic Roads or Regional Roads Victoria look after the through traffic function, so the road and the roadside drains, signage, and then all of the roadside stuff falls to council, footpaths, nature strips, trees, etc.
Okay, well, that's that question on that one. I just, you know, would hate to see someone badly injured or a child killed because of trucks take a long time to stop. So my second question, is that, do I move on to the second one? Is that okay? Is about the cycling coming into the town. And as you can see, I used to live in Bright, and there has been a change in that town with the community changing quite a lot, with a lot of events in the town. And I just want to, I suppose, draw the council's attention to what might be happen to Yakandanda and possibly Beechworth as well, with a lot more increase in cyclists with the rail trail and the proposed mountain bike trail. And I've put some five different points down there. And as I said, at the bottom, it's important for tourism, but there has to be a balance with what the community's needs are as well. And things like toilet facilities and estimated people coming in, the figures that I've taken from reports that I've read, and we're a heritage town, and what sort of impact, and people with their bikes. I don't want you to think I'm anti-bike, I'm just trying to look at the overall picture, having lived somewhere that has had a big impact on it, on the town.
Okay, Mark Florence.
Thanks, Vanessa. Really good question, and quite pertinent with some of the work that Council's doing with Yakandanda. So you're right, Yakandanda has a very distinct character, and we understand very closely with the community that the majority of the community wants that character to be preserved. At the same time, we need to underpin the future of Yakandanda as well. So tourism and economic development is important. So specifically, Council has responded by instigating the placemaking project in Yakandanda, which will look at a whole range of issues, a lot of the ones that you've talked about. So we're aware that, you know, 2 or 3 years' time we're going to have the convergence of the two trails. So, you know, we need to be ready for that. So some of the issues that you've talked about in terms of, you know, cycling infrastructure and those type of things are important. But equally in Yakandanda, there's issues around residential land. You know, it's quite reduced, limited. There's a high demand, a lot of people wanting to come to Yakandanda, so that creates pressures on residential land. There's a lack of industrial land at the moment. Traffic flow and all those type of things need to be considered, as, and that's before we get to community infrastructure and community services. So, so fully recognise the issues that you've raised there. I would really encourage you to participate in the placemaking project.
Yes, yeah.
Lots of consultation opportunities coming up over the next couple of weeks, actually. So, and those issues that you've raised here will be certainly at the forefront of the work that's being done.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, we were away in the UK for a few weeks, so I won't be able to be involved with that, but I'll keep
going. So I'll make sure that your concerns are represented to to the steering group.
Okay. And my final question is Flags Indigo Shire, which I know I've had some contact with, and I just wondered if we at the community centre could replace our flags until council have decided what's with the flags, because there's quite a few flags out again, and that was just a question to say, can we put them up again until this decision reached?
Greg Pinkerton.
Thank you for your question. Hi. So the way that your question is written just prompts me to clarify. We met, there was a group that met in relation to these flags, and the commitment from that meeting was that I was going to have a look at that situation and that particular case and respond. And I wouldn't mind catching up with you afterwards, because I think you might have missed out on a couple of group emails that came out of that meeting. So I think that might have prompted some of these questions. And so when you talk about the review, that was for me to have a look at this particular case and just understand a little bit more I gave some preliminary answers in the meeting, but I wanted to confirm that. So that was in relation to that building, not an Indigo Shire-wide review. And one of the questions that I was to look at is it time to have a look at the Indigo Shire-wide review?
Mm.
And the answer, which I believe you might have missed out on, is that there's nothing at this stage that prompts the management of Indigo Shire to recommend to council to do a review of those guidelines.
Okay.
So it was last done quite a few years ago now. However, most of these are signage guidelines relate to the heritage and in particular the centres of the towns. And that's based on a particular point in time, and so nothing has changed about that point in time that prompts us to say that there should be a change in the signage guidelines.
Right.
So I'd be happy to catch up with you and explain that further. And so in your question, it starts with, why were the signs needing to be removed? And that's because signage requires a planning permit, and then the planning permit is guided by the signage guidelines, and I know that you're aware of those, so
yeah.
I won't go over that. So the short answer is it didn't have a permit, and the answer is that those particular signs can't be displayed in a heritage area in Indigo Shire.
Okay. So any signs in Beechworth have had permits, the flags in particular?
So any signs in a heritage area, and Beechworth is a good example, would require a planning permit.
Okay.
And a lot of the signs that you see don't have planning permits.
Right.
And so council's approach in this situation is to educate and inform and assist before taking enforcement and compliance action.
Okay.
So out of the meeting that we had, one of the actions is that we, for many, many years, we've gone through that education process, but as business owners change and things change, we believe it's time to go through a new round of education,
right,
and then follow up with any action that's required to maintain the heritage look and the heritage values that Indigo Shire is really well known for. So that's really important.
Okay, so no flags.
No flags. That was a very long way of saying no flags, but I'd like to catch up with you separately and forward on the information that you've missed.
All right. We can't stay for the whole meeting, I'm afraid, tonight, so could I talk to you?
Yeah, or Delene would be happy to grab your email address.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, item number 7, the recommendation is that Council confirm the minutes of the ordinary Council meeting held on 26 March 2019 as published on the Council's website, and 2, confirm the minutes of the March 2019 as distributed separately. Would somebody like to move that? Moved by Councillor Shepherd, seconded by Councillor Murdoch.
I'd just like to add that two of the actions from the previous confidential minutes have come out in these minutes. So you'll see down the bottom of the agenda, 18.1 and 18.2 have both come out of confidential, and it's a new way we're doing it of trying to be more that we don't hold on to things in confidentiality for too long. And so we're saying now in our motions to when it's going to come out of confidential, and these are the first two that have done that. So, great thing, I think.
Thank you, Councillor Murdoch. Councillor Price, do you wish to sum up, Councillor Shepherd? Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item number 8, business arising from those minutes. Any deputations or petitions? Item 10.1, the recommendation is the Council accepts the year-to-date March finance and performance report, noting the progress against the Council's advocacy plan, annual Council plan action list, and capital works program. Would somebody like to move that recommendation? Moved by Councillor Trenery, seconded by Councillor Murdoch. Councillor Trenery.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Obviously, we're getting towards the end of the financial year, so these figures become more and more important. I just note with the capital works, obviously we're running about, and I can't bring it up right now, but we're running about the 40% mark of the capital works completion. We were in a similar position this time last year, so, and I think we got up to about the 80-90% odd, so I'm looking forward to that happening again. I can understand people looking at that being a little bit concerned, but I think a lot of the completion is, a lot of the work's been done, it just has to be processed in the budget for it to be recognised. But all in all, obviously the cash is in the right position, so I'm happy to recommend this.
Okay, Councillor Murdoch.
Program, and I note there that there's a We Are section of the advocacy plan under the affordable housing. We're requesting $40,000 from the state government for a seniors participation program to invest and investigate and prepare a plan addressing affordable housing in Indigo Shire. I think that's a really great thing to do, and I think that this finance and performance report is well done and has some quite bitey things in the back of it. Thank you.
Would somebody else like to speak to the motion? To Councillor Shepherd.
Yes, I just wanted to speak to the council action plan, and we can see that there's 13 actions that are being completed, and I won't read them out, but that's fantastic. Always what my eyes go to are what we haven't yet done and what we're behind in schedule. And the three that we're behind with the Stanley Township rezoning, which is we're still waiting, I think, on the CFA. We're working with them on bushfire compliance. Yakinetta Skate Park project, which we have got a contractor, they're just not available to November, so that is happening. And the bicycle safety initiatives on roads is, as we're putting Bells Flat Road off till next year, and a lot of that cycling I think is around there, and a couple of other roads that we're looking at that's just a little bit behind. And the only one that's not started yet is the review and update of the arts policy, and I'm not sure about that one. I'll check on that one.
Would anybody else like to speak? No, I don't think you can, Councillor Murdoch.
I was just looking that there's a slight mistake in here. It's just, it says here the progress on the Senior Memorial Hall kitchen, and to my knowledge it is the seniors' kitchen. Chilton, not the Chilton Memorial Hall kitchen that's being done, because otherwise somebody's in the wrong room. But it's looking great at the moment.
Good pick up, Councillor Murdoch. Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Trenery, is anybody against the motion? Carried. I'd now like to ask if a councillor would move to abandon standing orders and move a motion that the council plan recommendation in item 13.3 be moved to be acted upon immediately after 10.1, which is currently. Would somebody like to move that motion? Moved by Councillor Shepherd, seconded by Councillor Price. In that case, it's a procedural motion, doesn't have to be spoken to. So we'll move to item 13.3. The recommendation is that Council endorses the attached Council Plan 2017 to 2021 for the purposes of Section 125 of the Local Government Act 1989, with the following additions and changes. There are five changes and a large number of amendments in point one. In point two, authorises the Chief Executive Officer to give public notice of the preparation of the reviewed council plan in accordance with section 125(3) of the Local Government Act 1989. Three, invite any person wishing to make a submission in relation to the proposed reviewed council plan to do so prior to the 31st of May 2019. Schedules any person wishing to be heard in support of their submission to the reviewed council plan to be heard by council at a special meeting of Council on the 13th of June 2019,
5, considers a recommendation to adopt the reviewed council plan at the June ordinary meeting of council on 25 June 2019. Somebody like to move that recommendation? Moved by Councillor Shepherd, seconded by Councillor Price. Councillor Shepherd.
Yes, there's a couple of new things. I think the one that I'm interested in is the develop a reconciliation action plan. I think that's a we've added that into the plan, which I think we've just started. So that is we're setting out the steps required to prepare council for specific reconciliation initiatives and projects. So that's a good thing to add, I think. Also, we're changing the cycling and walking strategy as we've been listening to people, especially the horse riders, say that they'd like to be included in that strategy. So we've changed it to a trail strategy to include horse riding. And then, of course, all the amendments there are really, most of those are moving them on to another date because we haven't yet actioned them. So, yes, that's I think, the major changes.
Okay, Councillor Price. Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Shepherd, do you wish to sum up?
No, just to remind people that they have till the 31st of May if they want to comment on any of those changes.
Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 10.2, the recommendation is the Council endorses the attached 2019 and 2020 draft budget for the purposes of Section 127 of the Local Government Act 1989. It authorises the same process as to give public notice for people wishing to make a submission or people wishing to be heard, and considers a recommendation to adopt the budget at the June ordinary meeting of council. Would somebody like to move that recommendation? Moved by Councillor Trenery. Seconded by Councillor Shepherd. Councillor Trenery.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Obviously, this is a draft budget going out to the people, which is a big part of it, and I think one of the most important parts of it. So I won't preempt too much that are in it. I really am looking forward to the feedback. I would like to note a few things in regards to the draft budget. I've had questions on in regards to why 2 years have been put together in regards to the surplus deficit underlying figure. The reason that that has taken place is obviously because there's projects that go from one financial year to the next
financial year, so although we're running a deficit in this actual budget itself, when you include the financial year prior and the projects and the money that's being moved around, we're running at, I think it's about $253,000 surplus over the 2 years, which is a much better position to be in than a deficit. Also in the figures you'll see that there's a reduction compared year on year in cash spent on capital works. Now that, I did question that because I was a bit concerned about it, but the cash itself is at a normal rate within this draft budget. The change is that we also have projects come over about $2 million worth. So it's not actually a reduction, it's just last year we did work, or this current financial year we did a lot more work.
I think Greg Pinkerton a couple of weeks ago said to us, are you going to say we've got too much information now? We used to give you a double-sided sheet. And I've got to commend, I really do have to commend your department on the amount of work that's gone into this budget. I really love the service plan part of it. So, you now can go through and look at each one of our service areas and look at how the budget, how many people work there, what the projects are, and I think it's very transparent what we're spending your money on. So I think that'll be an interesting bit for you to read. We've also, there's a few new initiatives that I think that you might like to hear about. So we have an emissions reduction plan that we've put into this year's budget, into next year's budget. We're looking at a Rutherglen wine cycle loop scoping project, $30,000 towards a walk trail strategy, a caravan park strategy, the Chilton Destination Playground Scoping Project. So there's quite a few interesting things to read about in this budget, and you've got, again, you've got some time to read through it and give us your feedback. And there's a number of opportunities which you'll find probably on the webpage of where we'll be catching up with you.
Would anybody else like to speak to motion, Councillor Cross?
Just to echo a lot of what's already been said, and to say how pleasing it is that we're seeing the budget process develop year on year, and we expect that to develop further. It's really nice to see more information being delivered to councillors that we're then asking, can that be given to the community, and it's all been given to you. So you're getting as much information as us to really be able to understand the whole of council. And so now we invite your submissions, and we also are running similar engagement processes we did last year, where there's some drop-in sessions for you to attend, so we welcome your feedback.
Would any other councillor like to speak to the motion? I'd just like to comment that the rate is capped at 2.5% without any variation. The waste management charge will not increase by more than 2.5%, which I think is a great result. So, Councillor Trent, would you like to sum up?
I think you just did for me, so thank you very much for that. The other thing I was going to put also is that I think we have to have everything on the 31st of May. Is that right? 31st of May. So please, as quick as possible and as much as possible. Thank you.
Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 10.3, the recommendations of council accepts the attached assembly of council records. Somebody like to move that motion? Moved by Councillor Price, seconded by Councillor Murdoch. Councillor Price. Would anybody like to speak to the motion? Councillor Murdoch.
This is part of being open and making sure that everybody knows that we are actually working. We have been at quite a few meetings, a lot of these are committee meetings and some of them are briefing meetings, but it is the sort of work that councillors do to discuss, to consult with our community, and it's done sometimes face-to-face and often it's done in meetings where we have other members of the community who are like the Inter-Environment Advisory Committee working with us to give us advice that we take on board so that we can make our decisions much better. Thank you.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 10.4, which is a two-lot subdivision at Mayday Hills. The recommendation is that the council refuse the application for the proposed two-lot subdivision of Lot 9 on the following grounds. One, the proposed subdivision would create a land parcel, proposed Lot 81, devoid of any foreseeable beneficial utilisation. Two, the proposed subdivision would negate the existing management solution for the area of contaminated land. That is, the contaminated land is part of a larger parcel that is able to be developed with the dwelling and associated structures, uses, without proposing any feasibility alternative solutions. Three, the proposed subdivision does not comply with the requirements of Section 61(4) of the Planning and Environment Act 1987, in that the proposed subdivision would have the effect of bearing a registered restriction on the Lot 9 title without an authorising planning permit. And four, the proposal would appear to be contrary to provision of the Vantage Environmental Management Report, Section Seconded by Councillor Shepherd. Councillor Price.
I think within the recommendation itself, obviously the grounds are well set out, but they're not in the report in the discussion. It lists the officers' concerns that the contaminated land will be set aside as an allotment of such a size as to not realistically allow for the establishment of an ongoing beneficial use. This therefore might see future owner of the site decide to effectively abandon the land, causing concern to the community and pressure the council to step in and assume responsibility. And there's two other officers' concerns here. Any attempt to use the contaminated area might well lead to damage to the existing cap, as a majority of the proposed Lot 81, the contaminated site, would be covered by the existing cap. And the addition of additional contaminated material by the owner during 2018 causes uncertainty as to what additional area of Lot 9 will be needed to protect this additional contaminated material.
Councillor Shepherd.
The councillors went and had a look at this proposed two-lot subdivision, and the officers were with us and were able to very clearly show us their concerns, and I agree with the concerns that are raised here. I think they certainly are something we need to look at to reduce this subdivision.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Price.
Just to reiterate that I think it's pretty well summed up in the recommendation. The grounds have to be quite strong, and I think they are laid out there quite strong.
Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 10.5, the recommendation that the council note the New Springs Water Extraction Facility Monitoring Report content and the actions undertaken where required. Somebody like to move that motion? That recommendation. Moved by Councillor Price, seconded by Councillor Shepherd. Councillor Price.
Most people will be well aware that this is an ongoing monthly monitoring report that we put to council as council resolved to do it in the March 2016 meeting. So this is just us continuing with that.
So Councillor Shepherd. Does anybody else wish to speak to the motion? You wish to sum up against the cross? Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 11.1, which is Get Active Indigo Grant Program. Just wondering whether the person who moves this motion would like to refer to those which we're going to, who have been successful for these grants. Right. Moved by Councillor Price, seconded by Councillor Murdoch. Councillor Price.
So, Mr. Mayor, you're asking me to read them out from the recommendation?
I thought that you would like to speak to it.
So, the Get Active Indigo Grants Program came about from our Active Indigo strategy that myself and Councillor Goldsworthy were council representatives. So we,
as a council, accepted that strategy, and we've now been making our way through a list of priorities. And as a part of that strategy, there was this grants program developed where $30,000 has been set aside to try and fund some different ways to get active within the Shire. And so we received 14 applications, and we've been able to fund 8 of those. And with those that were unfunded, we've been able to suggest alternative funding streams for them. So I'll list the 8 that we've got. Social Sixes, Cricket Victoria, Yakandanda Cricket Club. So this is a Shire-wide initiative led by Yakandanda Cricket Club. A fitness and rehab program from the Beechworth Men's Shed. Pickleball at the Rutherglen Ag Society in the Henderson Pavilion. Soccer coach training for Yakandanda Football Club. So there's going to be, I think, 12 coaches to go through coaching training. Operation Rebuild and Grow for the Rutherglen Golf Club. Water aerobics and yoga at Indigo North Health and Chilton Neighbourhood House. Indigo U3A Gets Active, and the Junior Mountain Bike Program through the Beechworth chain gang. So I'm really pleased to see that we've been able to exhaust the $30,000. And as you can hear by some of those sports, they're outside of the normal, some of the more traditional sports. And it was highlighted in the grants panel, which I participated in by a representative from Sport Northeast and another one from Sport and Recreation, I think, that they were really pleased to see the impact that we can have with a small amount of money with $30,000. They were pleased to see the applications that we'd had, and they thought that it was a really effective way of supporting smaller initiatives and helping to start new programs that might help different age ranges to get active, which is our purpose through our Active Indigo strategy. So I commend the staff that worked on this. It's been a really thorough process, and I think they've done really well to engage with all of these different communities. And I also would say I think it's worth acknowledging each time that we are able to fund some of these activities that this is less money that these volunteers have to raise for their clubs. This money now their own money to continue to do more good things, and this is us helping to support them. So good luck, and I can't wait to hear about pickleball.
Councillor Murdoch. Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? So, Councillor Price, do you wish to sum up?
So this is the first year of the grants program, and those that applied and participated have also been asked to provide any feedback to the application process, and the panel itself also provided feedback. So we hope that this initiative will continue and it will meet the objective of encouraging more participation in recreation programs across a broad range of community groups within the Shire.
I might have missed it. Did you explain what pickleball is?
No. I'm aware that at Henderson Pavilion they have, Mark Florence, I can't remember the name of it, Life Ball, which is walking netball. So they've already got a sport outside of the traditional netball sports. I'm thinking maybe it might be something to do with that, but I'm not 100% sure.
So you don't eat it?
You could perhaps go along and participate, Mr. Mayor.
So, Councillor Murdoch, did you? Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Gary. Like to move that recommendation? Moved by Councillor Trenery, seconded by Councillor Murdoch. Councillor Trenery?
I'll just, probably with this, just a bit of explanation. The lease that they originally had when we were rejigging the long room in this lease was obviously for 50 years, and we actually reduced that lease in the initial motion. So this is basically fixing up that error at that time. So and then moving forwards, I'd just like to note, I think for those that don't remember, the reason why they got the long room and some extra room was to help veterans who were in need to get some private space and counselling at the time. So this is a very important, and probably even getting more important as the years go by, that this is that council action this. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Murdoch.
And also, the Return Service League do an enormously good job for their return veterans and people who actually do need help, and it's a lot of work. They have a lot of fun in other ways as well, but the work they do for the return veterans, I think, is fantastic. So this is just setting things right in a way, because the long room, as we said before, these council offices weren't being able to be used. It was a time when we were going around from town to town when we were having council meetings, which was really hard. But the long room now is not used very much, as it's been seen in this report. So I think it's a good use of it, and they will make very good use of it.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Trenery. Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 12.2, the Osborne's Flat Road Safety Improvements Tender Recommendation. The recommendation is the Council accepts the tender from XL Grey Bruni for the Federal Government's 2018-2019 Nation Building Black Spot Funded Safety Improvements on Osborne's Flat Road for the value of $545,917, excluding GST, and authorises the CEO to execute contract documentation. Somebody like to move that recommendation? Moved by Councillor Shepherd. Seconded by Councillor Price. Councillor Shepherd.
I think the great thing about this is that it's fully funded through the Federal 2018-19 Nation Building Black Spot Grants Program. So we've chosen someone who's suitably qualified and experienced, and it has here tenders were evaluated in accordance with the tender request, and then we have waitings. So I think it's going to be an exciting upgrade for those people that live, once it's done, in that section in Osborne's Flat Road of the 1.4-kilometre upgrade at Schultz Road, Wallace Road and Gap Flat Road.
Councillor Price, would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Do you wish to sum up, Councillor Shepherd? Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 13.1, the Hume Region Transformation Program Business Case. The recommendation is the Council notes that Inigo Shire Council is a participant in a grouping of councils making an application for funding under the Victorian Government Rural Councils Transformation Program for the following initiative. A, Hume Region Transformation Program in conjunction with Wodonga, Wangaratta, Moira, Mitchell, Tawong, Benalla, Strathbogie, Murrindindi, Mansfield and Alpine Councils, with Inigo Shire Council as the lead council. Two, notes that for an RCTP application to be eligible for consideration, the following criteria must be met. A, submission of a joint business case by 31st March 2019. B, each council must pass an accompanying resolution committing to implement the business case if approved for funding. The resolution must be lodged with Local Government Victoria by 30th of April 2019. Three, approves the submission of the business case by Inigo Shire Council on behalf of Inigo Shire Council. Four, approves implementation of the projects and initiatives within the submitted business case by Inigo Shire Council, subject to the application being approved for the RCTP funding. Somebody like to move that recommendation? Moved by Councillor Price. Do we have a seconder? Seconded by Councillor Murdoch. Councillor Price.
So as you've sort of outlined in the recommendation, Mr. Mayor,
this is a business case for the Hume region to a $20 million grant opportunity provided by the state government. And it's us working with a lot of our neighbouring councils to identify areas of shared service. So the process thus far has been that the business case has been submitted, which is seems in reverse that we are now sort of we're approving, I'm looking for the word, standing behind this business case, supporting the business case after it's been submitted, but that's just been the nature of the process. There's been five service areas that have been identified for transformation, and those are business systems, procurement, integrated landfill, recycling and organics, regulatory services and emergency management. And there's obviously a lot to be worked out if we're successful in this funding. So at this stage, we're just saying that we would like to put this proposal forward. And if we're successful in achieving, in receiving the funding, then we would work together with these councils and decide which ones we were going to lead. And Mr. Mayor, I'd hope that we could be a lead and a strong lead in a lot of them. Because it shows that we're looking towards our long-term sustainability. And as many have said, if you're not going to do it and be in charge of it, someone else will do it for you. So I think we really need to show strong leadership in this area. And yes, we've had problems with the process, but this is the process and this is us signing up to it tonight.
Thank you. Councillor Murdoch.
This, as we all know, that rural councils, small rural councils, find it hard to provide a lot of the bigger services that we want to provide. But if we do band together and we get this sort of money from the state government, then we have a better chance without having to find this money out of council rates. We have got an opportunity here for us, for the councils to be more efficient and to keep rates low for residents and be able to deliver some fantastic livability, which is written in here, but I think it's a really good way of describing it. We really want to provide better services for our community, and if we can get money from elsewhere, I think it's a good thing to keep going with.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Shepherd.
I'm always nervous looking at something this large and thinking about, is the state government looking to at amalgamation? Is this a stealthy way of amalgamation? At the moment, though, we are in charge of this process. So if we get the money, we will be able to develop the projects and provide detail that will be required for implementation. So I'm happy with that at this stage. It's also, at the moment, because we have that ability, it is a low-risk decision for us, I think. But I think that we have to ensure that even though they are operational areas of council, I still think that the community and the councils across all of these regions will be very interested in being involved in discussing projects around these business case.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Trenery.
I'd just like to read part of the Rural Councils of Victoria, the statement to the Victorian Budget Submission. Rural councils want to be more efficient. I want to read this because I think it really highlights exactly what this is about. Rural councils want to be more efficient to keep rates low for residents, spend revenue responsibly and deliver fantastic livability by investing in shared services, provisions, energy saving programs, collaborative procurement. Councils will be able to make every dollar go further. But we need state government's help, and we have to go through this process to get that state government help to set this up. I'd just like to congratulate Indigo Shire's CEO and staff for taking the lead on this. It's been a very, I suppose, time-consuming project, but I think a necessary project, and I think we've done a very good job on it. Congratulations.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? I'd just like to comment that you've all spoken very well. This is a very important thing for Inigo Shire. I think it's just great that we're the lead agency. There has been a lot of work go into it. I'm not sure whether all of those councils will be part of it, but I'd be very pleased to see Inigo Shire as part of that. So, Councillor Price, do you wish to sum up?
Just to say that it's not often that an opportunity for this much funding unmatched comes about, as the report says. And so I think, although, as we've identified, the process has been a quick one from the state government, I think that it's good that we're participating in it, and I think that it's good so that we're forced to find these opportunities and to collaborate with other councils in our region to future-proof the Hume Region councils, Mr. Mayor.
Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 13.2, the recommendation is the council receives the attached unconfirmed advisory committee minutes. Somebody like to move that? Moved by Councillor Murdoch, seconded by Councillor Price. Councillor Murdoch.
These are the minutes, or the unconfirmed minutes of the advisory committee minutes. And as you know, we have quite a few advisory committees, and they do some very valuable work by giving us advice, listening to some of the things that we may be doing, and giving us advice about that. I noticed one of the committees, which is the Indigo Environment Advisory Committee, has done some very valuable work over the time. Councillor Price, you're on that committee, and its advice has helped us in many ways to improve our services and to make sure that we look at the environment. But there are other committees, and they all have input, and we value it very much. So I have no problem moving this advisory committee minutes with what's in there. I'd love people to read some of the things that they do.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Price.
Just to note, in the Access Committee meeting minutes, which myself and Councillor Trenery attended, Penny Everingham came and gave us an update on the Beechworth to Yak Rail Trail, and it's been really important to us as a council that referrals such as this are made to the Access Committee to have them look over it through another lens. And it was really interesting discussion that came about as to what the surface would be and whether that's conducive to particularly wheelchairs, as one of our committee members raised. And that prompted a discussion of the different treatment just outside of our towns, because they'll be the most used areas by the widest range of people. And so it just shows the benefit in taking something like the rail trail to this committee, that they can have a look at it, also be really confident in it, and provide some really helpful feedback to make sure that this rail trail can be used by as many people.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Shepherd.
Just to note that the Indigo Environment Advisory Committee did strongly supported the emissions reduction plan being put into this next budget, and it includes a collation of a baseline inventory, an agreement on the scope and the data collection methods before we can really plan for our reducing our energy. We really need to have a baseline on where we are at the moment. So, and just to say that is in at the budget at the moment. So, depending on feedback from the community, hope that stays there.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Do you wish to sum up, Councillor Murdoch?
No.
Is anybody against the motion? Carried. Item 13.4, which is the confidentiality policy, the recommendation is that Council adopts the attached confidentiality policy. Somebody like to move that recommendation? Yes, Councillor Goldsworthy.
On page 4 of 5 of the confidential policy, it's page 578 in the agenda. The bottom, it speaks around, for council briefings to operate effectively, it's important that all matters discussed remain confidential until such time as a matter is published in the agenda of a public council meeting or otherwise becomes publicly available, that opinions and views expressed by others are not disclosed without their permission. I'm just wondering with a recent briefing meeting, so we have, back on the 26th of February, we spoke about a reconciliation action plan. On the 19th of March, we spoke about the draft youth strategy. If we were to speak to any of these items prior to them actually being listed for council discussion, would I be in breach of this policy? Direct that at CEO.
CEO?
So thanks for the question through you, Mr. Chair. This policy was written in response to a notice of motion earlier on which spoke about dealing with confidentiality. The really tricky part with this whole policy is to try to keep it, I'll say at a high level principles based, and try to have a set of guidelines that we all agree, as councils agree, in terms of what they want to see in a policy. A lot of this is going to depend on goodwill, and I think it's really tricky in a policy to say, to be really, really prescriptive to say what is and what isn't confidential, because clearly when we're talking about stuff in councillor briefings, there should be what this policy proposes, a general principle that people can speak open and freely without having things re-spoken about by others elsewhere outside the briefing. But clearly there's going to be a lot of things inside a councillor briefing that you're spoken about, which is general knowledge anyway. So it's going to take an element of common sense to know, look, there's some stuff in there that is confidential until it's ready for the open public debate. Often that's clearly indicated when it becomes part of an agenda paper than it is in the public forum. There'll be other things that are sort of in progress. There'll be things that are ordinarily public information anyway. So, you know, if someone was accused of repeating something that was in a council briefing but it was public information anyway, then you wouldn't be breaching it. So, look, I can't say to you, especially in a policy, list every occasion where something was confidential and stayed that way or really is public information and didn't need to be repeated. There'll be things discussed in there which are discussed in the community at the same time. So it's really tricky. So I think this policy tries to have a guidance, and I think it's going to still rely on the goodwill and good judgment and the actions and behaviours of councillors to say, well, really, you knew or you ought to have known that that was confidential, or sometimes you can take judgment and say, look, I think this item's actually public information anyway, so I'm not really breaching if I talk about this in an open forum. So it may not be perfect, but I think it goes a long way to at least giving guidance as to what is and what isn't confidential. So I know that's a long-winded answer to your question, but I think this is just going to come down to goodwill in a lot of cases.
So I was just looking for an answer to the question. Yes or no would be fine. So for the reconciliation policy, if we were to speak about it, because it hasn't come to the council meeting for an agenda yet, would I be in breach of this policy if I spoke about it?
I need to give that more thought in the context, and I probably can't answer that. just based on that initial question. I think we need more time to consider that, to be honest. I'm not sure what else you're looking for from me in that regard.
I was looking for an answer.
Would somebody like to move that recommendation regarding the confidentiality policy?
I'd like to move this item be postponed for another month, that further work be done on it to make it a policy that is more principle-based rather than prescriptive.
So you're moving that motion. Would somebody like to second? Would you like to read it back? Executive officer? Have you got that? Would somebody like to second that motion? Seconded by Councillor Trenary. Councillor Goldsworthy.
As people would be aware, I was the one that initially called for a policy to be developed. I'd like one that deals with our confidential information and releasing of it. I believe that the policy that's been put up, although it's been amended on a number of occasions, I think it's still too tight on what is and isn't confidential information, and I believe that it won't take long before councillors find themselves falling foul of a policy in which we may well adopt here tonight. So I would like to see us give it some serious thought. The meaning of the words in which they're written down here, they are very tight, and it means that effectively, we're curtailing our ability to speak freely to members of the community, and that concerns me. I want us to release more of our information, not less, and I believe this is making it harder to do that.
Councillor Trenary, would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Shepherd.
As one who straight away went back and spoke to anyone I could about the RAP because I was excited about it, and even spoke to the person who did the Welcome to Country for the Yakinetta Folk Festival, as I was emceeing, he was pretty happy that we were doing a RAP program as well. So it does make me think, oh, well, have I breached this by speaking to them about it, because it was at a briefing. We were told we're going to be doing a reconciliation action plan, but it certainly hadn't come to a council meeting or had it been published anywhere. So that does make me concerned. So I am supportive of us discussing this further.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Price.
There's been a lot of discussion about confidentiality, and I think we can all agree that we want to make as much information as possible readily available. I think that if we are going to adjourn this off for another month, then I think those with really strong views about this have to have some really active participation in framing up the policy, because we want it to be something that we can all agree to, and something ideally that we can all agree to, and something that we can all work within and be really, really strong that our policy says and does exactly what we want it to. But I think there's also a point where a policy has to say what it does say, and then, as the CEO has said, It's up to us to look more into the spirit of the policy and use our good judgment where there might be a grey area that the policy just can't define. So I support it being adjourned, but I also think that we have to have some really active participation in this discussion to get the policy that we want and be able to move it and go forward implementing it.
Would anybody else like to speak to the motion? Councillor Trenery?
A few things I'd like to say. This should be about getting more information out to the public. This should be about us being able to communicate one-on-one with the community or in groups of community, and this policy, I think, hinders that. I would have broken that policy on more than one occasion, on multiple occasions, probably on a weekly basis, because I talk to people and I want to keep talking to people about what we're doing and how we're going about it. And I've spoken to people about reconciliation as well. So the fact that the CEO can't even answer the question, I think, is fairly dangerous in regards to moving, getting this policy moving forwards. I think based on principle is a much better idea. We know when we've done something wrong, there's information out there that needs to be kept in-house for appropriate times, but 99% of it can be spoken about. This policy should be about more information getting out, not less.
Just a question for you, Councillor Trenery. Are you happy with 1 month if we're going to discuss it from between now and then? I just know that the schedules are fairly thick.
I don't think there's an urgency to it, so I'd be happy for 2 months personally, because then, look, you look at what's coming up in the next couple of weeks in briefing, there's no way we're going to fit it in there. There's absolutely no, we haven't got a hope. So I'd prefer, if the move is happy, to probably do 2 months, unless someone thinks there's some urgency, but that's a good point, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, Councillor Goldsworthy, are you happy with that? Okay, I was going to say something, but I won't. I'll now put the motion. I don't know. It's not an amendment as such. If it was an amendment, you don't have an opportunity to sum up. But seeing you move the motion, do you wish to sum up, Councillor Goldsworthy?
Only that I'm happy to work with the development of a policy that works for all of us.
I now put the motion. Is anybody against? Carried. Item 15.1, which is the Mayor's diary, there was a typo regarding a meeting with the local member, Bill Tilley, in Wodonga. The date should be the 15th of March. The next item is 16.1, which is the decisions register, which Councillor Shepherd referred to as 18.1 and 18.2, which was something that was in confidential and has now been taken out of confidential and put into the minutes of that last meeting. General business, Councillor Trenery.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yes, I'd just like to firstly note how well the Shire did on Anzac Day. It was a fantastic day. I managed to go to two events, the Dawn Service at Yakandanda and also the march in Kiwatangambalanga later on in the day. And I'd just like to note that while Cameron's been running the Yakandanda Dawn Service and morning service as well for 15-odd years, and this was his last year, so I'd just like to, on behalf of Council, thank Wal Cameron. I remember going to a service there about 15 years ago where the Army wasn't asked to come along, and there was about 15 of us, I think, and this year we had about, well, the park was full, so there was hundreds and there was horse riders out the front. We had a bugle playing. It was, of course, the Army was there. It really was a magnificent occasion. So Wal's done a fantastic job, and I'd just like to thank him on behalf of Council.
Councillor Shepherd.
I'd just like to congratulate the organisers of the Beechworth Festival of Change, which happened on the 1st to the 4th of April. I went to a couple of the events and I saw a few of our staff were also at it. It was a group of local people who organised an event to build skill, build networks and spark ideas to create positive social and environmental change. I met a CEO from a South Australian council who'd come over with a couple of her councillors. And so there were lots of really interesting and different people talking about how to create change. So I just wanted to congratulate them on the great job they did with lots of activities throughout the town. You might have seen a lot of people around.
Thank you. Councillor Goldsworthy?
I might just pick up on Councillor Trenary's point just on the Anzac Parade. I wasn't able to attend, but the Beechworth Parade, I believe there's still traffic moving along as the marches were going on. You attended. I'm just wondering whether that's something that needs to be addressed in the future. We've got traffic driving along virtually into the parade as they're trying to march down the road. Might be something to work with traffic management and or the local police. I'm curious, a while ago I requested a list of the damage to Indigo Shire assets from the flood in mid-December. I'm just wondering where we're up to with that, as to whether there's a likely list that might be prepared that we might be able to view.
Yeah, through the Mayor. Look, there has been a list compiled and I had spoken. We're probably just in transition between managers, but Brad Dinsdale has compiled that list and I'll follow up with him to ensure it's circulated.
Thank you. And another query I have, what's the current status of the developing a lease agreement with the Department of Education for the old Stanley Primary School? Is that still going ahead?
It is going ahead. It's back in the hands of the department to formalise the lease document itself.
Okay. And that's likely to be cost neutral for the Shire?
That's the intent, yes, of the... it'd be a peppercorn type of arrangement.
Yeah, but it won't be at any cost for us in maintenance or anything like that?
No, that's right.
Very good. And just in relation to the questions that were asked at the beginning of the meeting, what is the current situation with any damage being caused at the roundabout at Barnum Wather that was raised by Jonathan? Are we aware of any damage that's ongoing?
Oh, not specific of late. Over the probably past couple of years, there has been different reports of damage, and we spent some money there a couple of years ago. I'm not aware of any current damage that was alluded to earlier tonight.
Is there anything we should be looking at as a council about our responsibilities to the community and advocating on their behalf around the truck movements there?
Look, we do have a council plan action around reviewing heavy vehicle movements across the Shire. So we've deferred that. We probably felt as an organisation that the timing's not quite right, especially with the Rutherglen study going on. I guess in my view that the key question that's been asked tonight was really about the link between the roundabout and the Hume Freeway on Havelock Street. We've taken a view for a long time. It is a logical link and it's probably an omission when certain roads were gazetted that wasn't. So I guess by dealing with that as a permit, we exercise greater control than if it was gazetted, then we just walk away and forget it and heavy vehicles go where they like. But look, it perhaps does need revisiting it at some time. It hasn't been a topic of great debate in recent times, so there's probably not been much focus on it.
And since you raised it, the Rutherglen deviation, where is that up to, and when are we likely to hear from Roads Victoria around any proposed alternative routes?
Look, right now the latest is... Regional Roads Victoria obviously still working on things. When we went to the community forum a couple of weeks ago, they'd been in touch with some residents that day, so there was reports, whatever the date that was, a couple of weeks ago. I've since had some dialogue with Regional Roads Victoria. I know that they're still chasing up, you know, some information from the Oricon report and then some of the community reference stuff that was done around then, so they're getting engaged. They're getting advised by a third-party expert in traffic management stuff to help them with the next step. So I'm anticipating an internal meeting with their staff in the coming weeks, but I've got nothing scheduled at the moment. So, there is stuff happening, but I'm a little bit in the dark as to exactly what and when. They had probably a handful of weeks ago I was away. Staff from Regional Roads Victoria met with Paul McLaughlin, just to get, you know, some further data around a number of routes that have been identified as potential from their community liaison. But, you know, I think what had happened there was any number of potential routes have been identified by the community, and that's not surprising. So they were trying to, you know, whittle that down to something they can go back to the community with. But I don't know precisely what the next steps look like at this stage.
Okay. And just my last point, I was out at the Beechworth Mountain Bike Park on the weekend. An organisation called Blue Dirt ran shuttles there for the weekend. There would have been a couple of hundred mountain bike riders. I think it bodes well for the future. A lot of the riders weren't locals. They come from Melbourne and the like. So we've certainly got a product that people want to use. And when we get those rail trails and the Epic Trail in place, I think it will be big business for us.
Thank you, Councillor Murdoch.
I just want to add to Councillor Trenery's take on Anzac Day. Again, I went to three services, but the first was the Dawn service in Chilton, which when I first started going there, there was about three of us there. It was absolutely packed. And people were, you know, I suppose, realising that, you know, that this particular year is a very special one. We then, I went to Barnawatha and then back to Chilton, and Chilton has a really great habit of having a service at the memorial, and then they do a walk down to the memorial hall and have a speech or a talk about some issue in the First World War. And this time it was about the women in the war and the nurses, and they usually take up someone who has been from our local area, and we had two nurses, and I'm terribly afraid I can't remember their names, but the story was absolutely fascinating. It is I must congratulate the two Ians who run it, because every year for as long as I've been in Chilton, they have been running it, and they have a pretty good narrative at the end of our stroll or our walk down the street, and it's really great to see everybody, the whole community, get in behind it. Thank you.
Councillor Price.
I'd just like to congratulate the Chilton Athenaeum and in particular Alan Crichton on the success of the Ned Kelly weekend that they held in the beginning of April. They had a really successful event, and they're hoping to hold it again either next year or every second year. I think it's really fantastic that our small community Athenaeums can run these events. And just to follow on from comments about Anzac Day, the Mayor and myself attended the service in Wagunya, and it's always a really great service, and it was great to hear a story from another local family, which is what they've been rotating through for a few years now. We heard from the Granthams, and it's just really great to see that, as it is nationwide, it's a really proud tradition, and it's only getting stronger as each year goes by. And also thank you to the EA for the beautiful wreaths. We each got compliments on them on the day, so it's great that we've got a local business that's able to support us with beautiful wreaths on the day.
On Sunday, I went to the milk run at Kiowa Tangambalanga at the Huon Reserve. It was very good to see the toilets were open. They were certainly well used. There were a lot of questions about the NECMA land, and I said that I would raise it at this council meeting, and they said they'd watch. So do you have a report, Greg?
Yes, thank you for the question. I was able to get an update tonight, just a brief update from NECMA. So thank you to NECMA for the quick response on that. So the advice tonight is that the wheels are still in motion. This is an important project for both organisations. The plan of survey, so this is an old title. The depot has been on an old title for a long time, and needs to be converted to a current title. So the plan of survey is an important part of that process. The plan of survey was prepared, and in preparing that plan, it was found that the survey records held by the Crown along the Kiwa East Road appeared to be deficient. So it wasn't there was some sort of issue there. I'm not too sure what that was. So given that, they've approved a process to seek further information from the Office of the Surveyor General. So that's really just letting everybody know that there's a small process to go through. And it finishes off with saying that NECMA continue to progress the sale of the land, although, as identified, the process is taking time. So I suppose, in closing, I'd say again, this is an important process for NECMA, and we know that we have their commitment to work through these issues, and it's a very important process for council and particularly the people of Kiwa and Tangam who have been looking to this for many years. And so even though it's taking a bit of time, the wheels are still in motion.
Thank you. The only other thing that I'd like to mention is Anzac Day, and we're going to Council of Price, and I were there to a really large crowd. The school children sang, and then I went to the march in Beechworth. I took the salute. I didn't notice traffic issues, but that's not to say they weren't bad up further. At Wigunya, the traffic was blocked off, so there were certainly no issues. But Anzac Day was really big. They had four students from Beechworth Secondary College who spoke, and they were just marvellous. It was a very moving speech. So unless there's any other business to discuss, I declare the meeting closed.